Everyone's really missing it. And so it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker this morning. We have with us Dr. Pavlina Tcherneva, and she's an associate professor of economics at Bard College and a research scholar at the Levy Economics Institute in New York. She specializes in modern monetary theory and public policy and is a leading expert in this space. And we're so happy to have her here with us virtually over Zoom to speak to the case for a job guarantee, which she's spoken to extensively and has a book on this subject. And so we're very thankful to be hearing from a leading expert on this topic. And with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Tcherneva.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Liz. And to everyone who's joining, it's a real pleasure for me to be talking to your society. I'll preface my remarks with a critique of my own field, my own discipline. Economists are not in the habit of talking about ethics, which is completely ironic because economics began as a moral philosophy. It is a moral science, after all. There is a deep ethical content to what we do. And over the years, we've begun to talk about the economy as something that just changes automatically under some external forces that can't be quite changed, and you know, the inevitability of globalization, you name it. But at bottom, economies are social systems. They're not natural systems. And we have very deliberate say in what and how the economy works and for whom. And so, you know, the foundation of my remarks is the basic claim that we do live in a deeply unethical system, and specifically in one where the labor market no longer provides the very basic means of subsistence for the vast majority of working people. It doesn't support working families and creates conditions that are cruel and inhumane. To provide some diagnosis before we move on to the introduction of what the job guarantee is and what it aims to do, I think the context is important, and we all acutely aware of the difficulties that people are faced with. But just to put some numbers, half of working families in the United States earn less than $35,000 a year, 50%. About 30% of working families earn less than $20,000 a year. It's very difficult to live on this kind of pay. And so what my particular concern is with the perennial threat of unemployment, how the existence of this quiet, if you will, malicious phenomena actually changes all of our lives, working people or not working people. And so unemployment, we see it today. It's very high, it's acute. We've seen so many folks who have lost jobs as a consequence of the pandemic, uncertain whether they can return. And we've also seen under what conditions working people have been toiling away, you know, the so-called essential workers that are underpaid. And what's next? You know, we're staring in perhaps the greatest jobless recession that we have experienced since the Great Depression. So the first question here is, how do we return to normalcy, but also how do we change what's normal? We don't want to return to an economy prior to COVID, an economy that doesn't generate good, stable employment opportunities for all, and an economy that on regular basis, on a you know, average day, leaves millions and millions of people without work. And so the job guarantee is that proposal that not only transitions us back to a more stable economy, but also provides a foundational floor to working people and a guarantee that a decent living wage job offer will be available to all. As we think about what the job guarantee is, it's also important to highlight a couple of other aspects to the labor market. The first one is that, you know, unemployment, well, as I said, it's always been with us. It's perennial. And we, you know, we kind of quietly resign ourselves as something being, as it being unavoidable. But in fact, what unemployment does is it's a catch-22 problem. It actually creates the conditions that prevent people from getting employment and maintaining stable employment. So if you imagine the economy as what I often describe as a cruel game of musical chairs, meaning that there are only in a good economy, even forget about the pandemic, even in a good economy, there are not enough job opportunities for all job seekers. What ends up happening is that we have to ask the question, who gets the jobs, the scarce jobs? And so unemployment very quietly structures, you know, racial, gender injustices in the labor market. We know that folks who are hired last, usually caregivers who have been out of the labor market for a long time, folks with disabilities, people of color. And so in an environment where we have mass unemployment, there is always someone left behind. And then we are faced with another paradox. Firms regularly complain they cannot find, you know, qualified workers while we still have mass unemployment. So the bottom line is firms don't like to hire the unemployed. And then unemployment also creates very difficult conditions to obtain employment or hold on to employment. We know that mortality increases with unemployment. We know that health and health costs increase, mental and physical health costs increase. We know that suicides are highly correlated with unemployment. Apart from the health costs that the unemployed bear themselves, their children suffer, their spouses. The social costs are enormous. Unemployment is a major determinant of poverty, homelessness, and all of the other social and economic problems you can think of. And so people lose their social connections. They lose what we call social capital, the very necessary connections that serve as a bridge to reemployment. And so unemployment is really this catch-22 problem that needs to be resolved. And what the market, the economy does is it worsens these problems. Another thing that most people probably don't think about who are not economists is that unemployment is what I call a giant yo-yo effect. So what ends up happening is as soon as the economy slows down and there is slowdown in sales or profits, firms lay off workers. And that when they lay off workers, that actually perpetuates the problem. Folks lose their income. They can't go and spend as they did before. They can't, you know, pay for the summer schools and for the, you know, movie, going out to the movies or a restaurant. And so that costs somebody else their job. So unemployment multiplies. It actually quite literally behaves like a contagion effect. An unemployed person unintentionally throws another one out of work. And what we see is this huge explosion in unemployment rates in downturns, but recoveries are jobless. The labor market doesn't create employment opportunities for all. So the basic, you know, to sum up these macro conditions, these micro conditions of what is happening in the economy is that we bear enormous social costs. We inflict a lot of suffering as a consequence of tolerating unemployment. And most importantly, it's all paid for. It's paid for not just in the regular and in the regular ways in which the public sector has to address these problems. I don't just mean unemployment insurance, which is the right thing to do to provide to the unemployed. I don't just mean housing subsidies and food stamps. I mean also, meal lunch, school lunches. I mean the loss of opportunity, the loss of production in the community, the neglect that we tolerate as a consequence of mass poverty and unemployment, the loss of tax revenue at the local level. When we tally all of these social and economic costs, unemployment is actually a very expensive proposition. And it is far more ethical and more sustainable to provide what people seek, decent employment opportunities. And so that is what the job guarantee attempts to do, because what typically, the way we typically respond to unemployment is, well, with some unemployment insurance, and we, as you know, we are debating whether we need to extend unemployment insurance or we should leave millions of people without work and without income support. So that is in and of itself a very kind of, you know, cruel model in which desperation is supposed to bring people to the labor market that doesn't provide employment opportunities. The second response that we often hear from the public sector is, let's just train, give people more training. And that is a perennial response to unemployment. But if the labor market is a game of musical chairs, we are essentially training people for jobs that are not there. We are shuffling people along the unemployment line. And so training in and of itself may be a good response, but not an adequate response to mass unemployment. We also do a whole host of other things, hoping that they'll create jobs, and providing subsidies to firms and tax cuts. And we know the jobs just don't trickle down to the folks who need them. And so the most straightforward solution is to guarantee the employment opportunities. And so we know how to do this. We have had experience with creating employment in the midst of a mass unemployment crisis. And so we can certainly take a page from the New Deal experience and craft direct employment programs for people in the midst of the crisis. But what the job guarantee does is something else. It's a permanent program. It's a policy that will be there not just during COVID or after COVID. It will be a policy that will be there at a time when economists congratulate themselves that we have reached full employment, and yet there are still 5 to 10 million people who are still sending resumes, knocking on doors, being turned away, not able to support themselves. So the job guarantee is a permanent public option for good jobs. It pays living wages, and it establishes what we would consider a dignified labor standard, a pay and benefit package. So what would that look like? Like, if you imagine the United States, in every county in the US, there is an unemployment office that is called an American Job Center. And if you go into that American Job Center, you can get unemployment insurance, you can maybe get some courses, training, education. The one thing you cannot get is a job, or certainly not the guarantee of a job. And what if we devised a policy where communities in every one of those counties, the municipalities, localities, nonprofits together, corners of civil society were to propose projects for jobs that serve the community needs, that address some very concrete problems that that community may have, and essentially create bottom-up employment opportunities that employ those folks who come in seeking work. We can talk in a moment about what kind of jobs, how could you, run this and organize it, etc. But what I want to talk a little bit about is why this policy is a structural change policy. The first thing is, imagine if people had a legally enforceable right to employment, that it serves the public purpose to reduce all of the social and economic costs of unemployment, and that it is indeed already the responsibility of the public sector to address those problems. And that the employment solution is, in fact, a basic right. And that basic right has been codified in, we know, in the UN Declaration of Human Rights, but also it's a human right that FDR talked about after the Great Depression, when he spoke about the Second Bill of Rights, and that a decent standard of living has some basic prerequisites. The guarantee, the right to employment, was the first of them. Of course, it's not the only one. Right to education, housing, healthcare, all of those are different dimensions of a dignified life, of basic economic security. But the fact that we have not guaranteed, and we have a long way to go even on those other dimensions, but unemployment is one way in which we have undermined the floor, the economic security. And so the job guarantee is a structural policy that first provides a legally enforceable right to employment, but also it pays, how shall we say, for goods, not for bads, right? We're directing resources to do community rehabilitation, to do environmental work, to provide people with training, on-the-job training, to help them transition to paid employment, all of the positive benefits that come with employment security. At the same time, we are also establishing a very firm, uncompromising living wage floor. Think of it this way. We have minimum wages today. They are despicably low, right? We haven't changed the minimum wage since 2009, $7.25. If we were to raise the minimum wage tomorrow, that will go a long way, right? Well, you know, let's say raise it to $15 an hour. It will go a long way, but it will cover only people who have jobs. We still have millions of people out of work. So if you are unemployed, your wage is essentially zero. So what we really need is two policies to work together, a minimum wage and a job guarantee. In the absence of a minimum wage law, a job guarantee that provides $15 an hour with basic benefits, that becomes the floor for everyone. That becomes the standard, that becomes the basic job offer. And then that becomes, as I said, the standard that private firms must meet. Why work in difficult conditions for $7.25 if the community guarantees a living wage at $15? Private sector has to respond. It is, shall we say, the added competition that private firms need, the pressure that there is an alternative. What difference would that make to the lives of people? Will workers tolerate harassment, wage theft, difficult punitive working conditions if they know they have a public option? There will be a number, I think, of improvements over the lives of working people. And we know that firms don't have really trouble increasing wages whenever they're pressured to do so. They can raise wages overnight and they can meet the standard that the job guarantee is offering. And finally, what the job guarantee does that is a macro feature, if you look at it just from a bird's eye view, if you look at how the economy works on regular basis, the economy has, as I described earlier, a heartbeat. It grows and slows down. It grows and it slows down. And the collateral damage are always working people. They're the ones that are losing their jobs when the economy slows down. And we are now preventing that with a job guarantee. We're not going to stop firms from laying off workers, but it will slow down this process because now, instead of people falling into unemployment, unsure when the next paycheck will come, unsure if they can find employment, then they still have some stability in paying the bills, you know, meeting their daily expenditures. So there will be some layoffs, but they will not be, we won't see this avalanche effect of mass layoffs because there is some certainty that you can find a living wage job offer around the corner. And we no longer use unemployment as that perennial feature and allowing it to balloon and shrink over time. So the job guarantee is what we call a stabilizer, that is a better stabilizer than what we have today, that is unemployment. Finally, I'll just end with this and just open it to discussion. Finally, it's a public employment, public service job that serves the public purpose. It helps re-envision what we call a useful job, what kind of work we need. If it is the community that is creating those employment opportunities, plenty of communities have trouble with after-school activities for children. We can create many different kinds of projects or support existing projects through the job guarantee. There are some communities that are ravaged by environmental problems, right? Floods, fires. The job guarantee can address those. We have artists who need work, and we can create community theaters and after school programs, et cetera, that are part of the job guarantee. I think, again, the New Deal program showed us how creative communities can be and how many different projects can be supported, from oral histories to artists, to poets, to jazz musicians, you name it. Not just, you know, what we conventionally think of work as infrastructure, et cetera. And so the job guarantee is really the guarantee that if one goes to the unemployment office, they can be provided an employment opportunity, and that employment opportunity will be one that is designed according to broader social concerns, not the typical very narrow market concerns that create employment opportunity, a shortage of employment opportunities today. So I'm just gonna stop here and just open it to questions. And thank you.
Thank you so much for your remarks. And I see people are already starting to raise their hand. I'm actually gonna ask the first question since I'm presiding. I have like first in line rights or something, but I think, you know, I'm really glad that you brought up the New Deal. And I think it's something that most of us learn about at some point in US history and how important that was after incredible economic strife for so many people and how that really rebuilt our economy and gave people a lot of opportunities. I'm curious about why it's so different now and why that investment is not being made in, and not just infrastructure and things like that, but also the arts. It seems like this massive gap that we got right in the past, or seemingly got right in the past, and now we seem to be floundering and really doing so many people a disservice.
Yeah, I mean, I should say, I don't think that we have been very good at supporting the arts in the United States just traditionally. Even with the New Deal, I mean, we did support so many theater projects, and again, the oral history, the slave oral histories, and the jazz musicians, and et cetera. But we've never, as a society, considered it a public function to support the arts as other countries have done. So there is partly an ideological problem that we don't think of the public sector as, recognize that the public sector should support some of these vital functions of civil society, and the arts is one of those vital functions. The other thing is that we had the experience of the New Deal. And so it's a really legitimate question, like, why aren't we doing that since we've done it once before? And there are, I think, two reasons. One is that the New Deal projects were considered to be crisis projects. And maybe that's why we're paying attention to them now, because we're in the middle of a very severe crisis. But what I'm hoping that comes out of the job guarantee discussion is that we have this very quiet, force of economic injustice that is with us, even in the best of times. And there's no reason why we shouldn't be providing an employment opportunity to a person who needs one. Not a person who doesn't need one, for a person who needs one. And so number one, these direct employment projects are, they garner a lot of support in the midst of a crisis, but then they wane because they're phased out. As soon as the crisis is perceived over, then the projects are shut down. And then of course, over the years, we have really, and I think, you know, the Reagan revolution accelerated that problem, that we just don't do things directly. The government is not in the business of doing things directly, but instead attempts to do things through incentives in the private sector. And we know that those are not often aligned with social goals, with environmental goals. And we have a public sector for that reason alone. So we can have collective action to address collective problems. And unemployment is one of them. So rehabilitating how we think about government, I think, is critical.
Mm-hmm. Doris, I saw that you had your hand raised. Did you want to unmute to ask your question?
I love the plan, a guaranteed employment. My big question is, with all the people in this country, where is this money going to come from? We're broke right now. You know, we're suffering.
Doris, I'm so happy you asked this question, because we're not broke. And the reality is kind of staring us in the face. You notice how we respond to crises. Notice what we did in March. We got Congress together, and Congress passed a $2.2 trillion package that was spent. They passed it overnight. Where did the money come from? It was passed, it was spent. They didn't pick up the phone. They didn't call any rich donors. They didn't call China to borrow money from them, right? They appropriated the funding, and the federal government is self-funded. It has what we call these monetarily sovereign institutions. It has a central bank, it has a treasury that ensure that government payments don't bounce. And this is the reason why the federal government is responsible for the safety net, because it has spending powers that you and I don't have, that states don't have. You know, states are absolutely broke. They're absolutely strapped for cash. And so this is why a federal program is necessary. But what is truly extraordinary is that we have financial crises and we appropriate extraordinary budgets to deal with financial crises. We have endless wars, the money is always there. Mm-hmm. We have a pandemic, we appropriated the budget. I had calculated that budget would have been enough to pay every single wage in the entire economy for 3 months and employ all of the unemployed. It's large enough. But we just don't have the policies, the thinking about how to do it well. And so the other piece of this that I want to highlight is that we will be paying for the devastation from unemployment. It's just that, you know, the expenditures are baked in, because people will be suffering. Homelessness is going to skyrocket, poverty. We're going to be paying, you know, food stamps to every American. So those expenditures are there, and we just need to do it in a way to inoculate against these social costs. Right. And I think providing a job is the cheaper way, not just financially, but in terms of like the saving, human lives and social, reducing social costs.
Thank you for that. And Pedro, did you want to unmute for your question?
Oh, yes. Thank you so much for allowing me to participate. I am in Lima, Peru, as you know. But I became a member of the New York Society in 1991. Somehow, I think I helped in the by motivating a lot of people to manufacture the first mobile phone in the world, because I saw this mobile AT&T mobile phone on a display in New York City as I was walking around New York City. And mobile phones are very important now. To pay in cash, instead of using cash, now mobile phones are being used in most parts of the world. We have them as they have different names now that you can use your mobile phone, and it's like a wallet. They call them pocket wallets, so we are using less and less cash money. So that is one thing, how to teach elderly people or young people to use their mobile phones to make payment. Well, that's the first thing. When I graduated from law school in Peru, I made my thesis on labor law and on collective bargaining. In this current situation, collective bargaining is very difficult. I saw a case in Ohio of a company that merged with some Chinese investors, and they realized that the American workers could not keep that concentration on the job that was expected as the Chinese workers are. The Chinese workers said, and this was just a year ago, 2 years ago, this is happening now, that the Chinese workers, they are not allowed to talk in the production line. The Chinese workers only have two holidays in 1 month. And then they faced this situation that the American workers wanted more holidays, wanted better paid salaries, of course. So, and everybody's thinking of the $15 an hour. I don't know if that is enough. But I was taking notes, and quickly, I want to say the following. I am also a collaborator for Canadian, American, and Peruvian universities. And most professors are talking about artificial intelligence and how fast artificial intelligence is gaining, it's getting ahead of us. Then I remember from the first platforms where I participated back in the 90s, we started talking about corporate social responsibility. But this is very difficult in most of the countries. There are just few companies that respect CSR. So this is one idea I have, one suggestion I have, that there should be you are mentioning a guaranteed unemployment, like a fund. I think there should be also something called like a social guarantee or a social trust. In other words, corporations or SMEs, if they want to start a business, they should guarantee some assistance to the communities, mainly by creating local restaurants. And I say this because also when I participated at the platforms in New York City.
Do you have a question?
Oh, yes. So my question is, if you would suggest to create royalty or some payment for anybody who could make a social contribution, like the ideas that the Ethical Society proposes, if somebody suggests a good idea as a social contribution or a contribution for the betterment of societies, if that should be paid, if there should be some kind of royalty or a bonus, if you want to call it. That is my.
Okay, I think I got the gist of the question. So there are many ideas. I saw the American Factory documentary as well. It was really powerful and very important of how labor is faced with some global trends that are no doubt responsible for the decline in wages, the busting of unions and all of that. That's why it is difficult to incentivize private firms to create the employment conditions that we desire for all. We can do a lot, no doubt. We can pass a lot of laws. We could, you know, put a lot of regulations, incentives. I like this idea, right? Let's just give, you know, let's give royalties for some socially, you know, beneficial contribution. There's so much that we can actually do. The question is, will all folks have the capacity to take one of those jobs in those corporations? Will every single person benefit from these incentives? And I think that is essentially the task of the job guarantee, that it is a legally enforceable right to employment, and that is the responsibility of the public sector. So you can think of the public sector as doing the residual employment, We know the private sector still does the vast majority, the 80% of the employment. And we need, you know, we know that the public sector does already, you know, it already employs a lot of folks, but we have communities that are under-provisioned. We have social goals that are not met. We have so much work to do that is not done for commercial return. The incentives aren't quite going to be there. So we need the public sector to actually participate and provide the guarantee. On the issue of technology and, you know, AI, you know, technology is often pitted against work. And if we had a labor standard that reduced the working hour week, right, that said, this is the labor standard, we're going to have 30-hour working week. And I should say, I discuss it in my book, during the New Deal, when we put in place the 40-hour working week, that was a compromise, right? A much, you know, a very popular proposal was on the table for 30-hour a working week. It's long overdue. We need to do that. Some European nations have done that, but we can certainly use the job guarantee to establish that as a standard. Also, $15 an hour may not be, may well not be enough. It probably will need to be higher. And we need to figure out how to institutionalize very quickly to raise the floor for people without necessarily causing major disruptions in the private sector, but still pressuring them, exerting pressure that they meet that standard. So for me, the job guarantee will necessarily be that labor standard, but it will work a little bit better with a minimum wage that is simultaneously increased to the job guarantee wage. And then the job guarantee wage can have its own schedule of increasing the base pay, even if politicians are lagging in revising the minimum wage. The program itself can have its mandate to meet the living standard. And so they can be that pressure that it exerts. So I think, you know, technology in this world, in a world in which, you know, people can go into the community and find a project that they can work in and they like, and it is at a living wage, technology in that world is not really that big of a villain. Right? We should embrace technology and make our lives easier. Somebody was mentioning earlier about, you know, how overworked we are. And, you know, and so, you know, I think in this sense, technology then provides better quality of life.
Thank you so much for that and for taking time for questions. And we were running out of time. So I'll just thank Dr. Tcherneva for being with us today. And for sharing these great ideas and her insight. And today's giving, our charitable giving, will support